Shank, I am one of those business analysts, and I have with me Ravinder Singh, who is one of those developers who are going to talk about the technical discovery for a Drupal 8 project.
Hello everyone, good evening. My name is Ravinder Singh. I am currently working as a Drupaler with Susan Technology. Today we are going to share our experience of doing a first D8 project. So it is called as a D8 project. As it has been called by Sunil Gala in the pre-note session.
Yeah, so we got to know about the D8 project just recently. So yes, I'll quickly talk about the problem statement. This is one of the websites that we had created about six years ago. Then this project was in Drupal 6. I'm sorry. After 6 long years, this website needed a complete overhaul, and we thought, why not go for a Drupal 8 migration? But before that, we really needed some kind of an analysis. We wanted to make sure that we are not just migrating the website, but we are also redefining it completely and really making it future ready, because we want to make sure that it again lasts for 6 more years. This was the aim that we had really taken up from the front end perspective. From the left end, you see that this is the old version of the website, and right end is the newer version of the website. Of course, from the front end, you won't see too many things here, but really, we'll talk about what really happened in the back end. Basically, a slide about what really discovery is. I'd like to skip that and really move on to the part where we actually started with the convincing of the client. Now, client was a big publishing media house in India, and really we needed them to be convinced that we should go for a Drupal 8 website rather than going for a Drupal 7.1. And the client really wanted us to know why we would want to move to Drupal 8. Here are the reasons that we really talked about.
So as Shashank said, that the client is a media publishing industry, so we know that Drupal 8 has 200 plus new features available, so we have analyzed those features and recommended to client that which all features are helpful for client business. So the first feature that we identified, better authoring capabilities in Drupal 8. So it is most important feature, like the every content content management system should have. So in a D8, it is pretty much cool in a look and feel, as well as a clear layout. It provides inline editing. It provides editing from the blog, or it has a two column layout. And also, the other cool stuff is that it has introduced few new types of fields, like plus, links, phone, email, comments, etc. So the cool stuff that is very helpful for the deployment as well, so which is superior configuration management. So it helps us to import, export, and synchronize the configuration between the environments without moving the code base. So of course, this reduces the maintenance costs as well. So you know that we don't need very much expertise in the coding or deployment things. So we probably can export, import, and sync the files easily.
Right. The other two very major factors that we talked about and really wanted to convince the client about was that Drupal 8 was something that supported mobile-first approach. And primarily, one of the reasons why we wanted to do that was because in the last 5 years, we have seen a rapid growth in the users who really want to look at the mobile screens. From a mere 0.4 hours of their screen time, it has increased 600%, which is about 2.8 hours every day that a person looks at a mobile screen. So we really wanted to make sure that this website is mobile ready. We wanted to make sure that it is ready for mobile and up also. We also wanted to make sure that the client is ready to introduce interactive content into the website. Now, the client being the magazine one, he has traditionally really been very scared of introducing interactive content. And with Drupal 6 and the limitations that it had, he really never had a choice. What we really wanted to do with Drupal 8 was giving him that platform where he could use HTML5 and getting him the audio and the video support. Then there were, of course, availability of the new tags like header, footer, navigation, which really helped in accessibility also. And we'll talk a little bit more about it too.
Yeah, so and the other cool stuff that has been introduced in, which we have recommended for the client to expose web services, to expose news content to third parties. So later on that the client can use the web services for getting posted content from the third parties as well as posting them the content from the client side as well. So now that the client is convinced to be a guinea pig, so this is how we analyze analysis and how we approach the analysis. So this is the D6 side. So the main important part was the migration. So now in analysis we analyze the content types available versus used. So as Shashank mentioned that this project is not just the migration, that also we redefined it completely from the structure as well as architecture as well as design. So here we reduced a good number of content types. We mapped the fields that which were really necessary because remember that site is 5 years old. So and even that by doing this thing, we of course that we rewrite and reshift the lot of content as needed. So contributed modules. So when we had started this project, Drupal 8 was in dev release. So and we were trying to figure out that which all modules needs to be ported and where we could not spend time in customizing everything. So like the DAP, QuickTab, WebForm, Views. So these all are not available by the time. So the custom module, some of the code was written in, some of the custom code was done in D6, and some of them that we, okay, so we could manage easily, like sharing and widgets, because these were available as a contributed module in Drupal 8. So our decision to move to Drupal 8 was based on that there wasn't too much custom code required needed to port.
Yeah, really, it became a really good conversation point. We told the client that, listen, that the custom code that you have got is really very less, which means that I don't really have to port it too much to the Drupal 8 version. Some of it is already taken care of by the new contrib modules in D8. And some we can easily write and we easily move on. So that was one of the deciding factors really that we felt that this we can move to D8.
So you are asking, so this is the most important part of the quality, maintaining the quality of the product. So if we have old URLs anyhow, that this is the content site, news publishing site, so old URL going to be detected on the new URL. So at the time of the migration, we track the we keep a track of the old URLs, and in a new site we map them with old URL to new URL with the redirects, and we also got a suggestion from the SEO team to improve the URL pattern. So this is bad. This help to improve the SEO things.
Really, decisions. I mean, as a midterm summary, we would like to call these as decisions that we really had to take. Features versus config management was one of the important decisions, and we'll talk about it a little later, because at the time when we were actually using going ahead with the planning, we realized that both features and config management were not really stable. Entities versus node queue. I mean, node queue is still not available in Drupal 8. On the other hand, Entity queue also doesn't serve all the purposes. So really, it was a decision between whether we want to move, want to port node queue, or whether we want to hack or add a patch to entity queue and start using it. Custom versus port of module, like Ravinder said, that we really didn't have too much time on our hand. We had a deadline. We have to deliver the product by March 1st week. we really could not afford that we go about doing a complete revamp of all the modules. It was more like a time versus value kind of a conflict. And what we then decided was that we'll take help from the community. We'll ask respective people the kind of module that we want, whether they were looking to port it at some point of time or not. And if they were really looking to port it, we'll know whether their timeline is matching our timeline or not. If nothing is working out, we'll perhaps look for a custom solution. And then some better Drupal, of course. We 6 years ago, we also were learning Drupal 6. Right now, we are learning Drupal 8. But we had better Drupal sensibilities. So really using smaller features like user profile instead of a people content type was a sensible decision at that point of time.
Yeah, so after deciding what we are going to use here, how we develop the product, the project, so we organized the trainings for the DA team from the people that who are already into the community, so who are active contributor to Drupal 8 core and they are having some understanding, some basic concept and all these things on Drupal 8. So in the training that we covered D8 basics, module development, theme development, just all the basic as for a beginner just. So those who worked in, who has experience in D7, they found that D8 site building is pretty similar, so it was easier for them. Then we decided that we tried to cover most of the section from the site building section, as this was a media news site, so most of the things were achievable via views, blocks, display settings, all these things. So and other thing that the team was very active on the social channels, the Drupal groups and others like that, on IRC, and they were seeking the help on the Drupal.org forums. Also, they were actively participating in posting issues, updating issues on Drupal.org.
Really, guys, this helped us a lot because we were always at a crisis situation for a lot of issues. And the one place where we looked for information was the community, be it the IRC channel or the Drupal option. We tried using all of them. We wanted to make sure that we were getting our issues resolved as and when we really have them.
Okay, so here how we ensure the quality. So ensuring the quality was not a difficult task in this project because it we had old site as a benchmark, so which helped us to defining the acceptance criteria, or some of the acceptance got changed by the client after communicating with them. So this was not much a challenging task, but yes, the migration was one of the challenging tasks that we have to make sure that everything has been moved properly, or everything, all the URLs are working fine. So migrate and Drupal migrate module are in the code. We have used them. So migrate UI is not available as of now. So as Dries mentioned in the pre-note, that hopefully it will be in 8.1 release. We wrote automation script for testing the migration, and we checked the old URL are redirecting properly on the new URLs. So approximately it checked 20,000 nodes. Yeah, we also ensured that all the assets like images are migrated along with the content, along with their data and meta information into Drupal 8 site. Yeah, so here that how we planned the deployment. So this was one of the challenging tasks that our team faced. So initially we started using feature because feature we were having the experience on feature. So that's why we were confident that we can deploy the things via the feature, even that the feature is not made for the deployment, but most of the developer, most of the development companies are using feature for deployment. Yeah, so by the time the feature was in alpha release, we faced some problem with that, so we will talk about those. The config management, again that we face some issues with the config management, because it was configuring with some other module configuration that which were not getting ported on one environment to another environment. So that time the decision was difficult to us that how we deploy and how we can, but we decided to use the parcel, config management partially. And the other rest of the things that we have done manually, because even that we know that manual is not a good practice, but by the time we had to meet the deadline, so we used we have done some work manually.
Now CMI is really stable, and we would like you guys to actually start using it. Actually is a better option, we realized after comparing both features in CMI. And after now the better version is released, CMI is really stable and you guys can use it. Now I'd like to now wrap it up with some of the summary points that we really had, the things that we should really keep in mind while we are actually going ahead with our first Drupal 8 project. We have to realize that there are a lot of modules that are not available, and really we will have to struggle around that. We'll have to make sure that we are making a judgment call on whether we want to now port a module or not. Right now the expertise in D8 is very low. Everyone is a beginner, and the lack of expertise on OOPS concepts make it further a problem. So we have to make sure that that we seek as much information, as much help from people who are actually working on it. They are not really good enough articles that are available for Drupal developers to learn. Loads of research is required. Whenever there is a problem, and this is something that we really face, whenever there was a problem, we didn't realize immediately that whether it is our problem, our code that is causing a problem, or is it something that is conflicting with something else. At some point of time, we even started shouting at the server guys that, guys, you are making a problem for us. And really, we had to hear it back from them. We have to finalize an approach for a lot of features, really. Another few things that we really did was the search. Apache Solr just released a very stable version on 27th of Jan. By that time, we were really in sweat that perhaps we might not be able to deliver a proper search. We were even prepared to do a Drupal search at that point of time. But thankfully, now that a stable version is released, we are in a bit better shape. DFP and the ads, that was another very important aspect in our case. We had to write a proper custom module for the DFP where all some of the basic features that we really wanted have been written down, and we have taken those features from the D7 version actually. Hosting is another problem. Not everyone is supporting D8 at the moment. Everyone is jittery. Thankfully, we had gone ahead with Pantheon, and they had really helped us in identifying a lot of issues. They were patient with us. Whenever we threw a problem at them, they really looked at the logs and then helped us out where the problem could be, and we could fix it also. But really, this all meant was there was a lot of experimentation that was needed. Right, thank you. So thanks a lot, guys. Yeah, sorry.
So at the time of deciding the hosting, we decided to use the Pantheon only. Like by that time, the Pantheon just had launched the experimental D8 hosting. So it was not stable, even that when we were installing the site on the Pantheon, it was throwing some error on different site, the permission issues and all these things. So none of other system was supporting it, or even that every time the PHP version, some other version was getting upgraded. So this was one of the challenging tasks. But now Pantheon works fine for our project.
Right, thank you. Thanks a lot, guys. Any questions that you might have? The migrated content you are talking about, right?
Content.
Yeah, so yes, that was one of the challenging things, primarily because the structure had changed, but really that is what we really did. When we were using the migrate module, it helped us in defining that structure. There were other aspects like URLs that we need to capture, and then the redirection of the old URLs to the newer URLs. Those are the aspects that we need to really take care of. But other than that, the migrate module really helped us in making sure that the migration was done.
How long did it take for it to
migrate the complete content?
Part.
Yeah, so the actual content migration took a lot of time because there were a lot of cleanups that we had to do. So for example, some of the contents had false paginations available. We made sure that all those was deleted before the content was migrated. So the actual migration took us about 3 weeks, but really if the content was in a better shape, perhaps it could have been done in a week or so.
So when we had started migration, so that time we were doing some experiment on that. So first time when we import the content from D6 side, so everything came in our database. So we saw all the fields and all the relation entity and all things are coming in D8 side. But later on that when we had to clean up all these things, we analyzed, so in the analysis that we defined what things are going to map in what place. So by that time, that's why we have deleted a lot of content types. We have deleted even the lot of taxonomies because which are not getting used anymore.
Yeah. Thanks, Kamal.
First of all, congratulations for the amount of work you have done because I know the project. How complex it is and how difficult it is to understand the whole architecture and then to deliver it.
Right.
My question is like, apart from D8, do you use any other open source tools or technologies to deliver the project, or you use completely the general D8 features to deliver the project?
Yeah, most of the features like Ravindra also mentioned that we wanted to make sure that the realm is limited to the D8 site building only. There were few places only where some custom coding was required, and that is what was easily handled because not really too many complex things came up. So really we could handle it with some piece of custom coding, but rest of it was all D8 site building.
So as far as the custom coding is required, I can say that 10% of the whole project was on custom coding and 90% on D8.
I put 80-20 as that number. Yeah.
And how much time on understanding the initial architecture and the planning for the new information architecture and the delivery?
Right, so this was a technical discovery that we did just to make sure that we were understanding what we were getting into. Like we mentioned that Drupal 8 was a new beast for us. So we wanted to make sure that we were taking up all our time to understand it. And it was about 2 weeks that we took to do this technical discovery.
Analysis was done. For example, the content types. You just need to analyze, which are the content which are needed for the new site, which are things which are not needed for the new site. So similarly, one by one, you have to go to the taxonomy terms, the content types, the various vocabulary blocks, strike out things which you feel are not more required, add more functionality to the new contents, and I feel more than 2 to 4 weeks were required during the technical discovery.
End to end, how long did it take, the whole process?
So the project or the technical discovery? The project has been going on, so we are into the last phase of it. The final UAT is remaining with the client right now. So it has taken us about 3.5 months. So overall, technical discovery and the project itself.
And you also talked about some of the existing
Correct.
What are the learnings of the distinct from going on from 7 to 8?
So So site building is really not that difficult. It just doesn't take too much of time, and people can be up and running. If they have done some D6 or D7 work, they can be up and running. On the other hand, if there is custom coding involved, it requires a little deeper understanding, because the way the modules are now being written is a little different. So that requires a little bit of time, and depending on the grasp of the person's own custom coding capabilities, it could be anything. Fast learners actually do it very quickly.
And the Drupal Twig system is also wasn't new for the theming team. So this was one of the challenges by that time. So they took some time for fixing the issues, making their syntax clear, and achieving all the variables in the theme folder. Right? So.
Yes, at the moment, yes. Custom coding is the only option if there is no module available. And really, the first factor should be how many of these modules are really available. If it falls in the range of 80% to 90% that they are really available, perhaps we can now make a switch. On the other hand, we really evaluated this for another one of our other projects, and we realized that only 40% of the modules were really available, and there was a lot of custom coding that we really needed to do. We decided to not really go ahead with Drupal 8 for that. Absolutely, and that is what we also wanted to talk to the community, figure out whether they were doing it or not, and whether we can do it. But really, that part depends on whether we have a deadline to meet or not. Like I said, there was a balance that we need to make. We realized one of the modules, the add modules, really was needed to be ported. No one was taking it up, but it was an important feature. We decided to port it ourselves. On the other hand, there were some that were being done by other people. We took help from
them. So the important thing that the how much, what is your requirement in D8 for that from that module, right? What is your expectation from that module? So if you have very specific requirement, probably you can achieve those things in your custom module as of now, because that you have to meet the deadline anyhow. Yeah. Both?
No,
it's totally depend on the requirement.
Which would be the say better or more efficient or faster? Like, suppose we have got a version running in 6 and 7. Which would be easier to take it to 8?
Which is 7 to 8 would be easier, as I think. So that's my personal perception.
But I also believe that from the perspective of migration and really I have not personally done the migration, so I might not be the right person. But really, what I've heard is that from Drupal 6 to Drupal 8, the migration piece is very easy because this is how the migrate module has been done.
Especially when the legacy data is more.
Exactly. And that is where the migrate module comes in. It has been very helpful. I mean, the module itself has been very helpful in moving all the content from Drupal 6 to Drupal 8. We really didn't face too many problems. Of course, like Kamal mentioned, there were some additional scripts that we had to write, but really those were not really as big a problem as some of the other things. So we really think that this could easily have been managed.
And the migrate Drupal module is supporting for both Drupal 6 and Drupal 7.
Which file?
When you migrate the users, you should be preserving their passwords.
Okay.
Luckily, the site deals with the media content. So, we are mostly and largely dealing with the anonymous users reading. So, right now, we did not
Yeah, so from the user's perspective, we didn't move, we didn't have to worry.
So one more thing I want to add here, that in D6 side, we had a author content type for adding that who's published what. Whereas the actual thing was something, someone else was publishing the content on someone else's name, right? So in that case, we migrate the author content type to users in D8.
Yes.
You said you were using a dev version. Did you bump on any critical issues?
Yeah, initially we found some issues with the config management as well. We found some issues with the tweak system. But yeah, so with the help of community, we were able to resolve them later. But by that time, we spent some time, like 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, like on working on those issues. And even that, we organized the code sprint, and then we came to know the solution.
I have one more question in line to that, probably Craig can answer it. Like, Craig, you said you were using a dev version.
Talk about the password specifically. Drupal 8's password storage now uses the PHP5 password hash, but it has wrappers to handle old style passwords and then convert them to the new password hash to preserve them
alone. So you can still preserve the old password.
Well, it preserves the old hash until the first time someone logs in, so they only reset the password.
In D6, it was MD5 just. Right,
yeah.
So it was easier to migrate, but it would be difficult in case of D7 when we have implemented a hash or something like, right?
It's the same bit. And password hash for Drupal 8 flags, oh, this is a Drupal 6 hash, this is a Drupal 7 hash, this is a Drupal 8 hash.
Yeah.
And then if it's one of the old ones, it unwraps it, uses the old hash, and then we can use it.
Yeah, the algorithm is implemented.
Sorry?
Algorithm is implemented.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I have one more question. It's maybe not related to your project, but something specific to Drupal itself. Like, when you export configuration in the form of YAML format, like, you might have a out of sync situation. Like, you have made some configuration changes, you have taken it to live. In the live, client will be want to change something time to time. For instance, you might want to change the date format, which will change the feature state or CMI state. So it's going to have a different set of YAML files there, whereas in your Git repository, it's going to have a slightly different version. So how do we sync this?
CMI, okay, so if I remember from the last year, that previously the CMI was only based on the YAML file, right? So now that it is saving the all things into database and with the help of UUID. Right? Yeah, but it is not fetching from the file. So whatever you have in database, that will load first. And then if you want to rebuild or reload that, then you have to do it manually from the admin.
It will be basically overridden files, right? I mean, once we have made an override, and if it is then...
Like how feature does, right? So feature, once you revert, then it doesn't apply the changes from the feature file, right? Except the module file, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Right? Anyone else, guys? No? All right. That's a wrap then. We have more confidence now. Certainly.
Yeah, now we have one team, experienced team. Not a team, but experienced team,
now
ready for to do a Drupal 8 project.
Now we'll deep dive.
Still now the modules are not available.
But really, like I said, we are more confident now. We can.
Can you guys list down the priorities while judging whether you want to do D8 or D7?
Whether we should go to D7 or whether we can move to D8. These are the last two slides. These are the things that we really have to keep this in mind.
Can you prioritize it? Like module is number one. Right?
So one of them is of course the modules. The other is the structure, right? I mean, if there is a very complex structure and the amount of or there is a lot of custom code that is being written, those are the two parameters, two priority items that you will have to take care of. And once these are resolved, then you can easily take a call on whether we should move to D8 or not.
And even all the big modules are going to ported into D8, so you should be able to take a decision on to use a D8 for your project.
Right.
How do you deal with bugs in ported modules? Like
solve them.
Yeah, anyhow, that we organize code sprint, we solve them.
We really did that actually. There were at times. There are a lot of bugs that we really found. We posted them, like we said, we really posted them on D.O, fixed them, and then told them that we have already done the patch, please go ahead and use this.
But then, not being the author or maintainer of a module, you will not understand the philosophy behind how that module has been.
Yeah, but with the yes.
So there's a big risk in fixing a ported module who are not the author.
Yeah, this is fine, but in the Drupal community is very big. If you are available in the IRC, probably you can find out some top level of people around you, and probably you can post your detail, your issue in a detail. So if you give the detailed description of the issue, so probably the maintainer or someone else that who had used or who had faced a similar kind of issue can reply you easily.
In a couple of cases, we talked to the maintainer directly and figured out what was the idea.
Yeah, this is the primary approach that we should follow while using any contributed module to Drupal 8 site and which has some issues. So the maintainer should know first, because maintainer is only the person that who know the whole architecture of the module. But the people around us know much about those modules because the module has a big popularity. No, but it's not mandatory. So I tried to contact many of the maintainer, but I didn't get the reply, some of them. So after that, I tried myself to see the architecture and see the issue, what I want to fix, right? So I tried on that only. So it took the time, but yeah, this is fine. Even that, we can ask around people around us that how we resolve those type of issues.
That's correct. You'll be introducing spikes in.
So it has to be a huge discovery sprint followed by the decisions of the
Yeah, I mean, in agile terms, you'll be just introducing too many spikes, unknown spikes that you really not know about when you've actually dived into the project, and then at some point of time you might have to take a call immediately. So yes, it will be very risky when you're using that approach.
As for the performance of the site is concerned, what role did the Sova architecture play? Like you said that, and it was there, like, you know, earlier there was a problem in the servers, and you have to say to the server guys, because of you guys are facing problems, then you have to do that.
Correct.
So was there any new server architecture applied to it, or what was the role of it?
Not really. 90% of the times it was that some faulty module had a memory leakage and we had to fix it to get the things done. So really, it was just that when we were facing a problem, we figured out that something is not happening on our local system, but it is happening on the server. Let's hang the server guy. But then we realized that the module was itself leaking memory. So we had to fix that.
In 8.3, the latest Drupal 8
Yeah, so when we had started, the golden beta had not released, and we had started with the only the candidates. So that was the that was one of the reasons why we also felt a lot of problems with the servers. Now that the that the code is pretty much stable, it's actually doing very well. And I think in a very short span, I think Pantheon would be ready to start moving projects properly in Drupal 8 and not just on an experiment basis.
How you manage to arrive at an
estimate
with all these uncertainties?
Oh, we had a lot of fights. We'll talk about it later. We had a lot of fights with the client, really. Exactly. We had to really talk to the client after we were really stumped, and we said, we can't really do it in the budget.
Can we invoke custom views from V6 to V8?
Custom?
Views.
Views.
Yeah.
No, no, so we have developed all views in D8. Yeah. So there is a big difference between views, so I can't discuss here the difference between views in D6 and D8. And even that D7 and D8 views has again the difference. So we have some advantages like theme system is not available in D8. So you can't modify, you can't create a TPL for a specific field, a specific custom field or text, anything for that. So this is one difference. So you can go through detail about that. What is the difference, views difference in different version of Drupal.
Not wrapping it up now.
Any more questions?
Have you run into any unforeseen issues because of fixing coding module bugs? I'm interested to know this because we are currently in such a situation. Not the Drupal 8, but the 7. Like a module has probably some bugs which we are trying to fix, but we are not sure of the unintended side effects that it may cause.
So I remember there was. So there was a problem of edit page problem. I mean, initially what happened was that we were getting into the site, everything was, of course, everything runs rosy on the local system, right? Local systems never have a problem. So when we actually moved to the server and we realized that the edit page, when we are clicking on the edit page, it's just blasted. It just gave a white blank page, and we tried looking at different possibilities. And like I said, initially, the first reaction was go to the server guys and tell them, boss, this is a problem and we need to fix it. We really had to debug and figure out, and then at a later stage, after 4 days of really, really, real hard work, we realized that the problem was with the migrated content itself. If the migration was not done and we had not really migrated, for a very fresh installation, everything worked fine. On the other hand, if we had done the migration, then it was a problem. And when we actually tried going into that whole thing, what really happened, we realized that there was one field that has a handle, that had a broken handler, and that was causing all the problems, and that was leading to a edit page, and that was a, I mean, situation. Really unnecessarily, we wasted about 4 days just figuring out what really was the problem was. Did you have any other thing? And the problem with the entity queue otherwise also was that we cannot edit an entity queue. I mean, once we have fixed it, you can't make a change to it. You can't change even the content type that it is going to use. So if you want to do something else, we have to create another entity queue. So that was another thing that we discovered during when we were doing it, and we actually created a patch for it so as to be able to edit the entity queue.
Yeah, again, the best practice when we are going to patch a contributed module, in a contributed module, this is best practice to make it more generic and upload it into the issues queues of that module. So, and the plus point here, the other thing that you can do, that you can paste the issue URL to the IRC, Drupal IRC or anything, or you can ask maintainer. If maintainer doesn't respond, you can anyone will reply you on that, but it can take some time. But if to make it RTBC, that is awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. Right. So the first couple of slides actually talked about specifically the business logic of it and how the how we tried to convince the client. Of course, we could not convince the client about the technical aspects of it. Those are all ours to bear. On the other hand, we had to convince the client on the specific specific items that made sense to them. So, for example. So authoring capabilities was something that we talked about and told them why Drupal 8 was a better option for them rather than going to Drupal 7 or of course a different platform. Then the other option was other thing that we talked about was the mobile approach, and really Drupal 8 is something that is heavily built around that concept itself. So it was easy for us to sell it to the client. Specifically, like I said, when the client was looking to promote his website on mobile primarily rather than on the desktop. Even in the demos, he wanted us to look at the mobile screens rather than desktop. He said, desktop not done, I don't care. I want the mobile one ready because I know that the users are going to be on the mobile now. It's a magazine website, right? And people are going to just consume content and they should be able to consume it on the mobile level also. So those are really the two major aspects. Of course, web services and the leverage of HTML5 or the other layers that we really gave to the client. But these are the two really important aspects that fetched us the client's approval. And he.
Also, in the enterprise space, the enterprises are more moving from applications to data as well as architectures. Like, the way people give sense to accommodate our services and interact with other applications or data sources, I think that's a big value.
Right, very healthy conversation, guys. Thank you. Thanks a lot. And
thank you.